We are in October of 2020. Scientists, politicians, corporate leaders, civil society are all increasingly understanding that we have started the decisive decade in the history of humankind. Now, friends, that may sound like an exaggeration, but it is no exaggeration. We are currently deciding on the future of humanity. As we enter into this decisive decade, let's remember two very basic but determining facts. Number one, where finance goes, so go emissions, or so go emission reductions. Number two, every financial decision today locks in the attendant emissions, not for years, but for decades to come. That is why the finance sector has a primal role in addressing climate change in a timely fashion. Frankly, I cannot think of another sector that holds more leverage in determining whether by 2030 we will be at half of emissions from as compared to today, or not. Truly, it is you collectively in representation of the financial sector who will determine what kind of a future we have. So my friends, no pressure on you. Now, let's start with what progress we have made. In September of 2019, the Alliance of Asset Owners for Net Zero was launched. This was a small group of large asset owners who came together to commit their investment portfolio to be at net zero by 2050. The small number has grown to 29 asset owners, total of about $5 trillion, all of whom are working together to figure out how they're going to move their investment portfolios to net zero and how they will be working with the companies that they all partially own in order to make those corporations net zero by 2050. In September of 2019, practically at the same time, the Principles for Responsible Banking were launched under the leadership of UNEP-FI and many partner banks. Today, 189 banks representing 40% of assets of the global banking industry have subscribed to the Principles of Responsible Banking. 33 of the banks became signatories or members of the Collective Commitment to Climate Action. With over $13 trillion in assets, they committed to align their portfolios to reflect and finance the low carbon economy that is envisioned in the Paris Agreement. But it is my serious invitation for everyone to come together for further progress. The progress that we have now is critical and it is important, but it is not sufficient. We have to push further. Banks, take a page out of the Alliance of Asset Owners. It is time to work very closely among yourselves to ensure that you develop the protocols, the instruments that you need in order to get your lending portfolios to net zero by 2050. And insurance companies, frankly, you have a little catch up to be doing here. You understand the risks of high carbon economies perhaps better than anyone else. Before the Paris Agreement, I heard from several insurance companies that if we go above a 2-degree world, we would get into a systemically uninsurable world. So, insurance companies, my friends, it is time to step up and catch up with the others in the financial sector. There is currently no science-based, Paris-aligned, net zero emissions framework tailored for insurance portfolios. Yes, as investors, as asset owners, you have stepped forward. What about the other side of the hall? What about the insurance instruments? May I conclude? This effort to decarbonize the financial sector is not just about reducing emissions. It is about managing financial risk. It is about increasing financial stability in the medium and the long term. And ultimately, it is about prosperity. I know that you know that. And I know that this is why you are gathering around this round table. So I thank you for coming to this round table. I thank UNFFI and all their partners for their extraordinary leadership over the years and for their constant commitment to take next steps. And I look forward to learning about the next steps that you will take from here. Thanks, and have a great roundtable.